anybody?
A job. And I believe even Jerry, in honoring his what he's accomplished today and things like that, I'll guarantee you, if I'll step out of here and give him back to this pulpit, he'll tell you he's still got purpose in life. And I believe you ought to have purpose until you turn up your toes or until Jesus comes. I really do, beloved. And the Bible says, beloved, in verse 33, I love this very much, who shall lay anything to the charge of God's elect? It is God that justifieth. And that's why I'm so careful as a pastor. I don't judge people. I'm very serious. I do not judge people. They may be doing wrong, and I'll pray, but I'm not going to think that I'm better than they. And you know what I say when I see someone doing something wrong? I say, but for the grace of God, there I go.
Amen.
There
amen.
I go, beloved. No question about it. And he also, beloved, he purposed that we should be glorified, and he purposed that we should never be charged, no condemnation, and no separation. In the verse 37, it says, we're more than conquerors. Now, who are you a conqueror over? If you believe the word of God, you're a conqueror over Satan. Why? Because greater is he than in you than he that's in the world. And so you have a power. If you can only learn what God's direction is for your life. I believe with all my heart, beloved, that there's not a person in this auditorium. If you know Christ as your Savior, God has a purpose for your life. It may be a godly mother. It may be just a deacon in the church. It may be for a man. It may be a good job. He may be for you to witness to certain people. But the key is to find God's purpose. Find God's purpose. And if you can find that, you not only please God, but you find that you have a peace that you never knew before. And so don't spend your life just drifting, beloved, and just going around wondering, what am I going to do tomorrow? Find God's purpose. He justified you. He has a purpose for your life. And Jerry, beloved, he found his. And the Bible says in verse 34 that there's no condemnation and no separation, verses 34 and 35. And that's why I'm some careful about talking about people. And I learned a long time ago, I'll never forget it. I was about maybe 10 years old probably, had a neighbor in next door.
Where were you?
I was in Eastport, Maine.
Hey!
And I was talking about someone, and he was on my ladder right in his window. He was probably about 50 and I was about 10. He got down off the ladder. He came over and said, buddy, come here. And he put his finger right to my nose and he said this. If you can't say something good about somebody, don't say anything at all. And you know what? I never forgot that. And I've learned that if I keep my mouth shut and I'm some capable criticizing others, then I don't have to justify it later. And if the chicken don't promote the root. And so if I really believe it in my heart, and I do it, when I see someone else doing something wrong, I say to myself, my brother goes to God. But for the grace of God, that goes up. And I believe if I see a preacher, I may not agree with everything he preaches, everything he believes. If it's wrong doctrine, if he ever, in our church, I go out of my way to correct him. But beloved, my job is to preach the gospel. My job is not to live other people's lives. And I believe that many times, if a preacher's not careful, he can get involved in people's personal lives to the point that he shouldn't be. And we're all different, but the thing that I would hate about Roman Catholicism is that here's a person sitting behind a little screen and telling that priest everything you've ever done wrong. And now on his computer, he knows every sin you've ever committed, everything you've ever done. That's dangerous. When someone comes to me, beloved, I don't want to know your past. I don't want to know your past. We start today.
Amen.
Because the fewer things I've got in my computer about the things you've done wrong, the better off I'm going to be.
Yeah, amen.
Because if I know a lot of garbage about you, every time I see you, you know what?
There it is.
And so if a preacher's smart, when someone comes to him, unless it's a criteria of something important, forget the past. Unless it's something that has to be brought up. And I believe, beloved, that people make a big mistake when they don't forget the things which are behind. And I believe with all my heart that if each one of us is God's children would learn to practice that, we'd have much better churches. I've seen churches divided because of one or two people that want to spread rumors, sometimes not even true, and yet they would destroy the lives of people. And if you and I can learn, and members of this church here, if you can't say something good about somebody, don't say anything at all. If you and I would put that to practice, what a different type of Christianity we'd have. Amen?
Amen.
What a different kind. But anyway, the Bible says here, beloved, that we're more than conquerors. Conquerors of what? Conquerors over sin, conquerors over Satan. Greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. And so, beloved, if I'm right with God and following God's leadership, I'll believe with all my heart that he will lead, guide, and direct. And that's what Jerry has done over the years. I remember very well when I first got to know Jerry at that meeting at J.O. Groom's. Jerry walked right in and sat right down in the front row in the first seat there. I probably shouldn't. He didn't dress the same back then. There was a style of long hair back then. Jerry had real long hair. It was really pretty, ladies. You should have seen it.
But anyways, beloved, we've been given an inheritance, and we've been sealed by the Holy Spirit. The thing I love best, Ephesians 3:11, we've been given an eternal purpose. An eternal purpose. What is our eternal purpose? To share the unsearchable riches of Christ, to make known the manifold wisdom of God, and to save us and to call us, and to have Jesus destroy the works of the devil. And I believe that Jerry has been trying to practice those things over the years. I think he's come a long way. But the reason he's come a long way, he's had a wonderful wife to get the job done. Amen?
Amen. Amen. No argument.
I could say a lot about Jerry, but I won't. But as a church...
He's practicing that thing. If you can't say something good about somebody, don't say anything
wrong. As a church... A church needs purpose, and that's where the pastor comes in. And deacons, if deacons would only be willing to work for the pastor if the pastor is really trying to do his best.
Deacons, if you stand in back of him, it makes a total difference in the church.
And I believe many times, I don't know that Jerry's ever tried to institute things, but times change, and things change. We can't go back to 40 years ago. Why, if anybody came to church 40 years ago with boundaries on, the people at the doorway would actually believe. That's the way it was. Everybody came with suits on. It's a different world today. And what we as pastors and deacons have got to learn to do, we've got to learn to adapt to some of the changes of the times. Not the doctrine. We don't change that. But I'm talking about the way a church is held. Music. If 35 years ago had good live and musicians clapping, I'd be so, I'd look ugly and they'd all stop. But today you can clap your hours. So that's how things have changed over the years. And I believe as Christians, as long as it's not contrary to Scripture, we ought to be willing to make some changes. So if Jerry becomes a pastor and he suggests some changes, give him a chance. And if you're right and he's wrong, then get on your knees and say, God, change his heart. And straighten him up.
That's the thing we'll do. Well, he's a hard man. But anyway, beloved, I'll tell you something. I'll never forget, I think I told you, the day that Jerry came, that I remember him so well.
I was sitting there, J.O. Boomer, our speaker, a very special man.
Amen.
And he came in, he walked in, sat right in the front row, sat right there. I'll never forget it. He made an impression, he really did, the way he walked.
But then Jerry started coming and became a friend. And I've always been pretty impressed with the way he's tried to serve God.
Amen.
So listen, all I can say is, you got a good man here out of this church, and let him know it, and treat him good, and thank God for the lovely wife he's got to keep him straight. And I'm going to turn it back to him, but I want you to know something. I'm proud of him. I'm not just saying that because he's here to listen. But beloved, he made a decision to serve God, and he's never turned back. And to me, that's a key. When you put your hand to the plow and you don't turn back. I've got one thing I wanted to leave with you. It really blessed my heart, beloved, and I hope that it'll bless yours. Let me share it with you, if I may. A wealthy man and his son loved to collect rare works of art. They had everything in their collection, from Picasso's, from Raphael's, and they would often sit together and admire the great works, the father and his son. When the Vietnam conflict broke out, the son went to war. He was very courageous, and he died in battle while rescuing another soldier. The father was notified and grieved very deeply for his only son. About a month later, just before Christmas, there was a knock at the door. A young man stood at the door with a large package in his hand. He said, "Sir, you don't know me, but I'm the soldier for whom your son gave his life. He saved many other lives that day, and he was carrying me back to safety when a bullet struck him in the heart and he died instantly. He often talked about you and your love for art." The young man held out his package. "I know it isn't much. I'm not really a great artist, but I think your son would have wanted you to have this." The father opened the package. It was a portrait of his son, painted by the young man. He stared in awe at the way the soldier had captured the personality of his son in the painting. The father was so drawn to the eyes that his own eyes welled up with tears. He thanked the young man and offered to pay him for the picture. "Oh, no, sir. I could never repay what your son did for me. It's a gift." The father hung the portrait over his mantle, and every time visitors came to his home, he took them to see the portrait of his son before he showed them any of the other great works that he'd collected. The man died some months later. There was to be a great auction of his paintings. Many influential people gathered, excited over seeing the great paintings and having the opportunity to purchase one for their own collection. On the platform was a painting of his son. The auctioneer pounded his gavel. "We'll start the bidding with a picture of the son. Who'll bid for this picture?" There was silence. Then a voice in the back of the room shouted, "We want to see the famous paintings. Skip this one." But the auctioneer persisted. "Will someone bid for this painting? Who'll start the bidding? $100? $200? Another voice shouted angrily, "We didn't come to see that painting. We've come to see the Van Goghs and the Rembrandts. Get on the real bids." But still the auctioneer continued, "The son, the son. Who'll take the son?" Finally, a voice from the very far back of the room, it was the longtime gardener of the man and his son. "I'll give $10 for the painting." Being a poor man, it was all that he could afford. "We have $10. Who'll bid $20? "Give it to him for $10. Let's see the masters." $10 is the bid. "Won't someone bid $20? The crowd was becoming angry. They didn't want the picture of the son. They wanted the more worthy investments for their collection. The auctioneer pounded the gavel. "Going once, going twice, sold for $10. A man sitting on the second row shouted, "Now, let's get on with the collection." The auctioneer laid down his gavel. "I'm sorry, the auction's over." "What about the paintings?" "I'm sorry. When I was called to conduct this auction, I was told of a secret stipulation in the will. I was not allowed to reveal that stipulation until this time. Only the painting of the Son was to be auctioned. Whosoever bought that painting would inherit the entire estate, including the paintings. The man who took the Son gets everything.
Amen.
God, beloved, gave his Son 2,000 years ago to die on the cruel cross. Much like the auctioneer, the message today is the Son, who'll take the Son? Because you see, beloved, whoever takes the Son, he gets everything.
Amen.
Praise God, praise God.
Amen.
Jerry, she's all yours.
Amen.
God bless you, brother.
God bless you.
All right, man.
You too.
Hey, brother.
I love that story. It hits home. So as we're going to continue on. So the next thing is Mrs. Mitchell is going to have her kids' choir sing a song. You want to say something? Okay. Let's change that. Dr. Mitchell is going to say something.
Remember when Ed Muskie called you Dr. Franklin on the platform? I said, Dr. Franklin, these people know more about the J.O. groom story than you do. Here's how this one goes. I've been coming there a while, and I go in and sit down, and J.O. Grooms comes and sits with me. He's got a red Bible. Whenever a pastor mentions a preacher, we don't call him pastor, he's a preacher. Whenever he mentions a verse, boom. J.O. opens it and hands me the thing and always sat with me, talked to me, came and visited the house and everything. So I'm walking out of there one day and I'm not saved. And preacher is at the back door shaking hands with everybody with his big smile and all of that. And he says to me, it's about time, isn't it? About time you got saved. Now, I'm saying this for your benefit because they've heard it about a dozen times. And I said, yeah. He says, if I come tonight, I'll talk to you.
Is this live?
Oh, perfect.
No.
So I said, well, if I come here tonight, I'll talk to you. He says, now, wait a minute. With me, it's either yes or no. Either you're coming tonight or you're not. I said, okay, I'll come tonight. Joe Grooms is off to the side. He says, now, preacher. He said, maybe he's ready to get saved right now, which I'm real happy about because I know I'm headed for hell and I want to get saved. But Buddy says, now, wait a minute, J.O. I know Maine people. And when they're ready, and when they're not, they're not. So I walked out unsaved. Thank God I didn't get killed that afternoon. And then I didn't wait to talk to you. I came down during the invitation, and I got saved.
Amen.
And Chet Littlefield led me to Christ. By the way, Mrs. Edna Franklin, her brother-in-law is Roger Reed, that you've probably heard me mention a few times. So this is old home week. Now, he says, you don't want to be a Catholic and talking to that guy behind the screen, right? We have life action singers in there, and they hand out the sin sheet. And you got like 50 different sins, and they tell you to check off whichever one you're guilty of. Okay? I'm looking at that thing saying, hey, I'm smarter than this, you know? And a pastor gets up and he says, I took one look at that sheet and I put a big X right through the whole thing. Guilty of all of them. So there's a couple of things that come to mind. I want him to say something about Woody Woodworth before you're going to be here tomorrow, I'm assuming. Does he preach? He preached. Great. Praise the Lord. Amen. Yeah. Yeah, I didn't think you were going to put him on the plane after this. Okay. Nice seeing you. Boom. So great. You're preaching tomorrow. I want to hear about Woodworth. I want to hear all the old stuff. Everything. This is like old home week when I hear everything he said, you know, and it's just just like being back there. And you know, Pastor Franklin, you know, I haven't had pastors for a large part of my life. Pastor Franklin, I think about 4 years, and Pastor Smith, another mentor of mine, for basically about three, and Fred Needy for about three, and that's pretty much it. Had Raymond Tracy for 1 month, W.E. Dowell for 1 month, and then settled down in Southside with Fred Needy. But all of these things, you know, it's remembrances. And, you know, it's a funny thing, you know, 25 years is a long time, and you build up relationships over time. But sometimes in the early years of your salvation, those are so, you know, I mean, they're like yesterday to me. You know, until I look at the preacher and realize how old he looks, then I know it wasn't just yesterday. But anyway, you do look good, preacher.
Gentlemen, may have your attention. I want to introduce to you
in this corner, good and right, stands a champion robed in white.
His heart exceeds the heavens, his weight outweighs the world, his reach reaches everywhere, his age is evermore.
Champion going down.
But I will never count him out, for I'm witness of his love. The day he rose to attain the title, champion of love.
Amen. He is higher than the highest, greater than the great. No one will ever take his crown away.
He's more mighty than the mightiest. He reigns from above.
He's the only.
That's a pretty tough act to follow, right?
All right. Okay, my job is, on this point is to mention a couple of the ministries that have come out under Pastor Mitchell's mentorship and just guys that have kind of come out of this church that are notables, kind of his, some of his preacher boys, as you were. So a couple of them are just Pastor Jerry Cook from Freedom's Way Baptist Church in Santa Clarita. He's been out there over 10 years, right? 13 years now. Pastor Chet Hansen of Fundamental Baptist Church in Santa Ana, who is here. He'll be, I believe, talking briefly not too long from now. Again, I mostly turn wrenches, right? The lights that work, good. Speaking, not so much. Pastor Jim Owenby, Missionary Jim Owenby, missionary to Mongolia. Evangelist Shannon Scott, Pastor Max Graves of Liberty Baptist Church in Norwalk, and Glory Bound Baptist Church in Stephenville, Texas, Pastor Ron Ray. So those are some of the guys. Mark Rule, too. Pastor Mark Rule ordained at this church and just a fantastic member to have around. Just, you know. And that's just to name a few. There's quite a few people that if we all just stuck our heads together, there's guys out there, friends, guys we went to Bible college with, guys that went to Bible college just as a result of speaking to you, being under your mentorship, you know, guys like Alney. I don't think I see him here, so we can't crack jokes about him right now. you know, just so much, a lot of guys out there. So what else should I say, Steve, or should I hand it off to someone else now?
Does Jerry Cook happen to be here yet? Jerry's on his way.
Oh, no.
So, as Buzz was talking earlier, a few of the, to some of the ministries that have come out of Pioneer Baptist Church under Pastor Mitchell's mentorship, we have three of them that were not able to be here today that were mentioned, but sent in letters, and they want us to read them. So I'm going to turn it over to Ben to start off.
My accent expertise was completely blown on the Ruckman bit. So I'm not even going to try this one, but this is from, we know him as Brother Jim Bob, but this is missionary Jim Owenby to Outer Mongolia. He's got a little preface here. He says, there are way too many items of interest that took place during the time I was at Pioneer Baptist Church with Brother Jerry for me to try to single out just one, but please pass this along to him. Brother Jerry, 25 years gone by, and I know they seem like just a few weeks or months at best. Time flies when you're having fun, as they say, and I'm thankful that the Lord brought us together and instilled a camaraderie between us that has stood the test of time. Having served in the missions ministry for over 15 years now, Many pastors, preachers, evangelists, and missionaries have crossed my path, but truly, in my opinion, only a Bible-believing, Ruckmanite Air Force officer sticks out head and shoulders above the rest. Brother, you have been the epitome of the definition of what a true friend really is. You're well aware of all the things that have gone on in my family and ministry, and never once did you ever turn your back on me or waver in your commitment to being there when I needed you. Congratulations on reaching this 25-year milestone. Stay in the fight and keep this in mind. It is not the critic who counts, not the man who points out how the strong man stumbles or where the doer of deeds could have done them better. The credit belongs to the man who is actually in the arena, whose face is marred by dust and sweat and blood, who strives valiantly, who errs, who comes short again and again, because there is no effort without error and shortcoming, but who does actually strive to do the deeds, who knows great enthusiasms and great devotions, who spends himself in a worthy cause, who at the best knows in the end the triumph of high achievement, and who at the worst, if he fails, at least fails while daring greatly, so that his place shall never be with those cold and timid souls who neither knew victory nor defeat. That is from the man in the arena, President Teddy Roosevelt. Amen. Lord bless you, brother, Jim Owenby. Amen. Second here is from a local pastor, Max Graves. Dear Pastor, as I sit here and reflect back on the past 25 years of my life as it has intersected yours, I'm reminded of Paul's words to the saints at Philippi in Philippians 1:3. I thank my God upon every remembrance of you. I can't help but utter these same words about my mentor, my friend, my father in the faith, my pastor, Jerry Mitchell. Thankfulness is what comes to my mind, and for many good reasons. I am thankful for your example of faithfulness. The scripture says in Proverbs 26, most men will proclaim everyone his own goodness, but a faithful man who can find. If you have been an example of anything in this life to me, it has been faithfulness. Faithfulness, steadfastness through difficult times. Whether it was your battle, whether it was a battle for health, a trial of faith, or a stand for truth. Thank you for your testimony of faithfulness to the Lord. I am thankful for your commitment to train young men. The scripture says in 2 Timothy 2:2, and these things that thou hast heard of me among many witnesses, the same commit thou to faithful men who shall be able to teach others also. Your willingness to take me and others under your wing and instill in us the importance of sound doctrine and a love for the word of God is thankworthy. This has left a lasting impression on me to commit myself to those that God has entrusted me with. Your example has borne much fruit. As a result of your commitment, as far as I know, there exist two English congregations, one Spanish congregation, a mission work, and a Bible translation project among the Kamea tribe in Papua New Guinea, a full-time evangelist, a young man training to be a missionary to the Jews, and only the Lord knows of the others that may come should he tarry. Thank you for your commitment to reproduce yourself in the next generation. I'm thankful for your diligence as a witness for the Lord Jesus Christ. You cared for my soul when I was lost. The scripture says, 1 Timothy 1:2, unto Timothy, my own son in the faith, grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and Lord Jesus and Jesus Christ our Lord. As a 14-year-old boy, I sat in your office on a couch across from your desk as you opened your Bible and shared with me the words of life. That afternoon of May 10th, next weekend, 1990, I bowed my head in repentance and trust the Lord Jesus Christ alone as my Savior. It is an honor to be your son in the faith. As a result of your diligence, as a witness for Christ, you have not only a son, but grandsons and granddaughters, great-grandsons and great-granddaughters in the faith. As I have had the privilege of bowing my head and hearing my own children trust Christ as their Savior, I am reminded of your witness, and for that I will always be thankful. Please forgive me for not being present with you today as you celebrate 25 years of faithfulness to the Lord as pastor of Pioneer Baptist Church. I regret that I could not be there, but I will never regret your friendship and example of faithfulness to the Lord. With love, your son in the faith, Pastor Max Graves, Maxie, and family.
So I played on two softball teams back when I thought I was an athlete. Pastor Franklin was a pitcher on our church team. So Arnie Stone, we'd be ahead. We had a good team. He'd say, okay, you can go. And he'd release me to go over to the church team. So I go over to the church team, and Pastor's the pitcher. And he calls the whole team together. He says, listen, we need Jerry in there right now. He said, now, I can't sit down, or I would. Well, one of you guys have got to sit down.
Okay, this is from Evangelist Shannon Scott. And he wants this letter to be read. Dear Pastor, I want to congratulate you on a milestone in your life. I wish I could be there with you to celebrate, but you have Buddy Franklin, so you will do well.
Amen. Amen.
Wow, 25 years of service. Thank you for staying faithful. I appreciate all you have done for me and my family. Though we celebrate from afar, we want you to know we are very grateful for your help over the years. As I was reminiscing, I realized the beginnings and first at Pioneer for me. Wonderful, necessary, and important starts through your ministry. Pioneer Baptist Church first came into my life while I was wayward. I needed God more than I knew, and my dad pointed me toward Pioneer. When I came, I found what I needed: God, His Word, and the care of a pastor and loving church. I remember fondly Sunday nights in your office before services with the men. We talked, you printed your message, we watched you tie your tie, and then we prayed. Good memories. I think that's, I'm having that right now, Pastor. Never could beat you in basketball. Oops, please don't publish that last statement. I figure if I wait a few more years, I might be able to finally win a game against you.
No way.
I was called to preach the gospel under your ministry. November 26, 1995. I was encouraged to preach and study the word through your influence. You always made much of the pure word of God. You brought in preachers to emphasize the word of God and preaching it. And it was always good when Joe Hill came for a visit. There were also men like Joe Boyd, who was preaching the night my wife got saved, December 7, 1996. She was also baptized there the next night. In addition, Cecilia and I were married there June 28, 1997. You conducted a memorial service there when Sebastian passed away. I made many lifetime friends there. We have many joyful memories of you and Pioneer Baptist Church. You are in many ways still my pastor. So I thank you for being my friend and an important pastor to me. I appreciate God using you in my life. Cecilia and I will never forget you. God bless and enjoy many more years of service. Your friend, love, Shannon. Revelation 4:11.
I've never seen you smile so much. So that's it for in this building here. We're going to adjourn, go over to the fellowship hall. Over in the fellowship hall, we'll... Oh, Cookie! What I just said, forget it. Come on up, Jerry.
Cook, you are now standing between these fine people and lunch.
So remember, this can't be a marathon.
These are Baptists and food, so you know the rules.
So when you're done saying your thing, pray for the food. I can do that.
I just told the preacher. I said, here came Gertrude, and then came Peter Reckman. And they said, We got your mentor and pastor, whatever they said. And I said, they've got Jerry Cook. He's going to come out and imitate Buddy Franklin. That's exactly what I expected. When he came out that door, I thought I was going to drop dead. We've already heard from the real good preachers, Shannon Scott, Max Graves, and those guys. So, you know.
No comment. Dr. Franklin, Mrs. Franklin, Pastor Mitchell and Mrs. Mitchell. My wife and I, our intention was to be here a little earlier, but obviously we had a graduation over at Pacific Baptist College, and as being part of the board, I had to be in the processional, and I realized I was doing the benediction, and so I tried to finagle all that, but unfortunately I couldn't get out of it. I wanted to be here to see all the particulars that were going to happen, and of course you know me, I want to be in the middle of all of it, as opposed to coming in at the end of it, but nevertheless it's good to be here at least to partake of part of this as opposed to none of it at all. But let me just say briefly, as I mentioned just a few weeks ago when I preached here on a Sunday night, there are two men that have been very, very instrumental in my life. One of them is sitting back there, Pastor Lyle Smith, and his dear wife, Mrs. Smith, and their vision for this school and their vision for this church and their continuation in the ministry so faithfully all these years. And then, of course, Mrs. Mitchell, who I knew first as Mrs. Drinkwater, and whom I thought maybe we would have made a really good couple initially. But I was much too young. I don't know. Yeah. They don't know who that is. But every once in a while, we all have those little things going on in our lives. However, Pastor Mitchell is one of those men that has been very instrumental in my life. Let me just say something. As a professor over at Pacific Baptist College, I have the privilege of mentoring and trying to help the next generation of missionaries, evangelists, and pastors, and so on and so forth. However, one of the things that is a common refrain that I hear from the students, especially the male students, is, you know, our pastor hasn't given us an opportunity to do this, or our pastor hasn't given us an opportunity to do that, or whatever the case might be. And I often give them the opposite refrain and say, well, that's too bad for you because that wasn't the case with me. As I was growing up here at this church, I got saved under the ministry of Brother Smith, and then, of course, was really mentored under the ministry of Pastor Mitchell. There were two things that he reinforced. Number one, believe this book. Amen. From cover to cover. In fact, I even believe the cover. It says Jerry Cook. And the second thing he emphasized is you need to rightly divide God's word. And one of the other two books that is key to me, first of all, is the Word of God. Second thing is Dispensational Truth by Clarence Larkin. Amen. I think those are indispensable works that I think are paramount for a man to get around and build a work of God and be able to not only bake the bread of life by preaching it with fervency and with energy, but you ought to be able to break the bread of life and be able to teach people and give them the particulars of the Word of God. And if it was not for Brother Mitchell, I don't think I would have had that background. If it wasn't for Mrs. Mitchell being faithful, teaching fourth grade, listening to some of my stupidity and putting up with it, and then, of course, Mrs. Smith in first grade and then in sixth grade, and just all the things that they had to endure. This is the product of your endurance. Exactly. You're enduring it right now. But 25 years in the same place is faithful. And I thank God for Pastor Mitchell. I thank God for his wife who stood by him through all those years. And I thank God for his family. And I thank God for this church and what they mean to me, to my wife, my family, and to the extended family, Freedom's Way Baptist in Santa Clarita, California. Good to see Brother Franklin here today. I still remember the two messages that Brother Franklin preached here several years ago when I was just attending the church as just a little insignificant peon. Now I'm on the board. Now I'm chairman of the board as of yesterday, and you're just pastoring in Norwalk. Nevertheless,
That's right. But truly, have been blessed greatly by both of these people. And I am just so glad, both my wife and I are just so glad to be a part, as small as it is, to be a part of this today. Let's pray for the food. Or do you have anything else to say, Brother Steve? Do you want to say anything? You don't have anything to say. I've said it all. This is the pièce de résistance. Okay. Father, we thank you for the opportunity today, Lord, to highlight 25 years of faithfulness. Thank you, Lord, for Brother Mitchell. Thank you for Mrs. Mitchell. Thank you, Lord, for the family. Thank you for Pastor Smith, Mrs. Smith. Thank you, Lord, for this extended body here, Pioneer Baptist. Some of them have come in, Father, to celebrate this moment. And Father, thank you, Lord, for Sister Franklin and Brother Franklin here today as well. And Father, their safe travel mercies from the grand state of Maine. And Lord, we pray that you'd bless our fellowship. Father, help us to be mindful that all that we say and do over the next few moments will be to honor and glorify the Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you, Lord, that we still live in a country that is free. Father, the freedoms are slipping away, but we still have some freedoms. But most of all, Lord, no matter what happens down here, we still have the blessed book that we can preach from and boldly proclaim as God's preserved word of God. We thank you again, Lord, for all of your goodness, for it is in your holy and precious name we ask it. Amen.